Good day, viewers. We thank God for another opportunity to sit again at the feet of Jesus and learn of Him. We trust that this study will bless your life and as well bless your family. We are still continuing our discussion on personal attributes that displease God. And our topic today says sexual perversion. Before we look at the aims of our study today, I'd like to introduce our resource persons. Our Father in the Lord is here again, Reverend Canon Olusegun Majekudumi, the Vicar, the Anglican Church of the Epiphany, here in Abuja Diocese. You're welcome, sir.
Viewers, you're welcome.
And then by my right is Mrs. Adeola Bako, a seasoned Bible study teacher, the Anglican Church of the Pentecost. Ma, thank you for honoring God today.
Thank you for having me.
Okay. Our aims for our study are to properly understand what constitutes sexual perversions. Two, to recognize those who indulge in it and or promote it. And finally, to realize God's position on the dangers of sexual perversion. Quickly, Ma, can you help us read Genesis chapter 19, 1 to 9? Reverend Canon, sir, Leviticus chapter 18, 22 to 23, and I'll read Romans as we build the discussion from there.
Genesis 19, 1 to 9. Now the two angels came to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. When Lot saw them, he rose to meet them, and he bowed himself with his face towards the ground. And he said, "Hear now, my lords, please turn in to your servant's house and spend the night and wash your feet. Then you may rise early and go on your way." And they said, "No, but we will spend the night in the open square." But he insisted strongly, so they turned in to him and entered his house. Then he made them a feast and baked unleavened bread, and they ate. Now, before they lay down, the men of the city, the men of Sodom, both old and young, all the people from every quarter, surrounded the house. And they called to Lot and said to him, "Where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us, that we may know them carnally." So Lot went out to them through the doorway, shut the door behind him, and said, "Please, my brethren, do not do so wickedly. See now, I have two daughters who have not known a man. Please, let me bring them out to you, and you may do to them as you wish. Only do nothing to these men, since this is the reason they have come under the shadow of my roof." And they said, "Stand back." Then they said, "This one came in to stay here, and he keeps acting as a judge. Now we will deal worse with you than with them." So they pressed hard against the man Lot and came near to break down the door. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Reverend Canon, sir, Leviticus.
Leviticus chapter 18, beginning at verse 22. "You shall not lie with a male as with a woman. It is an abomination. You shall not, nor shall you mate with any animal to defile yourself with it. Nor shall any woman stand before an animal to mate with it. It is perversion." Yeah. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Romans chapter 1 from verse 22. "Claiming to be wise, they instead became utter fools. And instead of worshipping the glorious ever-living God, they worship idols made to look like mere people and birds and animals and reptiles. So God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their heart desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. They traded the truth about God for a lie. So they worship and serve the things God created instead of the Creator himself, who is worthy of eternal praise. Amen." That is why God abandoned them to their shameful desires. Even the women turned against the natural way to have sex and instead indulged in sex with each other. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relationships with women, bond with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of this, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserve. Since they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, he abandoned them to their foolish thinking and let them do things that should never be done. Their life became full of every kind of wickedness, sin, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, and gossip. They are backstabbers, haters of God, insolent, proud, and boastful. They invent new ways of sinning, and they disobey their parents. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let's look at the introduction together. Sex was ordained by God as a lawful and decent act of expressing love and increasing intimacy between a man and a woman who are lawfully, legally joined together in holy matrimony. Sadly, in the name of civilization, liberty, and human rights, there are all kinds of sexual perversions which are even being legalized in some countries. It spreads across the globe, and God's wrath will come on those who engage in sexual perversion unless they repent. I think today God is touching a very pertinent issue in our time. In the wake of globalization, civilization, we are seeing so many anomalies coming on, even the way people sexually relate with each other. Traditionally, we know it's a man and a woman, but we are seeing modern philosophers redefine sex. I think as we study together, we'll look at what the perspective God has and then try to channel our minds to the right way that we should all walk as Christians. I pray that God will help us together as we look into this study in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Study guide. Reverend Canon, sir, can you help us define and discuss sexual perversions in your own words? Especially looking at Genesis chapter 19, 1 to 9, where we just read, sir.
Thank you very much. In that passage we have just read, we saw men, and the Bible said, both the young and the old come to Lord's house and insisted his visitors must come out because they wanted to have carnal knowledge with them. To have carnal knowledge of men by men is perversion.
Exactly.
Serious perversion. Even when Lot wouldn't allow them, they threatened in verse 9 that they will treat Lot worse than those visitors.
That's right.
So sexual perversion is a type of human behavior, or types of human behaviors, that deviates from that which is understood to be orthodox and normal.
That's right.
Which is not the way God has made it. God made them in his image. And he made them male and female. And he says, so shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and they will become one flesh. Any other thing that deviates from that is totally abnormal.
Thank you, sir.
If God had wanted man to meet with man, God will not give Eve to Adam. He will give him Steve.
Yes, sir.
So that it will be
Adam.
But God never made it that way. What we understand is that anything outside of the norm of the heterosexual, that is, sex desire between man and woman, is out of it.
Thank you very much, sir.
Of course, the word perversion can also be used in other senses. I mean, you can pervert justice. You can have a pervert mind. But most of the time, pervert is negative.
Yes.
But particularly in the Bible, you see this perversion word used over and over and over again where it concerns sex.
Thank you very much, sir.
You know, and sorry, and what you find is perversion is mostly used when they are talking of behaviors that are particularly abnormal. Very abnormal, repulsive, and obsessive.
Thank you very much, sir. You know, it's in, as we are sharing these wonderful insights, I recall that in that scripture, even Lot voluntarily wanted to offer his two virgin daughters.
Yes,
yeah. But their level of perversion was so deep
strong.
That they say, no, we don't want women, we want men.
It's completely obnoxious.
Yes.
And we are seeing it happening in our time. Ma, what are the various forms of it? Reverend Cannon has helped us to look at this perversion. What are the various forms? Let's look at Leviticus 20, verse 11 to 17. I will invite you to help us read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9 quickly, and then we'll share from there. Leviticus chapter 20, verse 11 says, if a man violates his father by having sex with one of his father's wives, both the man and the woman must be put to death, for they are guilty of capital offense. If a man have sex with his daughter-in-law, both must be put to death. They have committed a perverse act and are guilty of capital offense. If a man practices homosexuality, having sex with another man as with a woman, both have committed a detestable act, they must both be put to death, for they are guilty of a capital offense. If a man marries both a woman and her mother, he has committed a wicked act. The man and both women must be burned to death to wipe out such wickedness from among you. If a man has sex with an animal, he must be put to death and the animal must be killed. If a man presents herself to a male animal to have intercourse with it, she and the animal must be put to death. You must kill both, for they are guilty of capital offense. If a man marries his sister, the daughter of either his father or his mother, and they have sexual relations, it is a shameful disgrace. They must be publicly cut off from the community. Since the man has violated his sister, he will be punished for his sin. Let's take 1 Corinthians 6:9 quickly.
1 Corinthians 6:9 says, do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexual, nor sodomites.
So what are the various forms of it? Looking at this scripture, ma.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
From the scriptures, it's so clear. It's there. That if a man lies with a male, in that case, we're talking about homosexualism, where a man lies with a man. A woman lies with a woman. That's lesbianism. It talks also about a man having sex with an animal or a woman having sex with an animal. That's bestiality.
Yeah.
I mean, it's totally repulsive. And then you have a case where the sister and brother are sleeping together, or father sleeping with daughter. That is what we call incest. And it's a capital sin. So it's all so clear what God did not want. And we see the result of it, that anyone that indulges in all these things is death. And apart from this, there are also other things which men do, which we call necrophilia. That is having sex with dead bodies. Hmm. You know, you can imagine. And then you have masochism, where you derive satisfaction through pain. In other words, when they beat you, they continue beating you, you derive sexual satisfaction through that, which is, I mean, it's repugnant. You know.
Thank you very much, ma. Thank for also going extra to kind of share those insights with us. Because we see men, maybe for want of power, in pursuit of wealth and power, going to burial grounds, sleeping with dead people and all whatnot. And then, you know, it's interesting when the scripture says, these are capital offenses.
Yes.
They are not trivial.
No.
They are grouped under, and we know what capital offenses are in our normal system of justice.
Yeah.
So we should be careful, and I pray that God will help us. Reverend Canon, sir, let's get back to you. Looking at question 3, from contemporary experiences and the scriptures, identify and discuss the traits of those who practice or promote this act. We will not be reading Romans again because we've read it. I just want us to quickly read Isaiah chapter 3, verse 9. Isaiah 3:9. We look at that scripture, and then canon, you will help us. Isaiah 3:9 says, 3 verse 9, the very look on their faces gives them away. They display their sin like the people of Sodom and don't even try to hide it. They are doomed. They have brought destruction upon themselves. Identify and discuss the traits of those who practice and promote this act.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
If we look at the scriptures behind that number three, it says, professing to be wise, but they become fools.
Utter fools.
You know, there's a saying where they say, there is pleasure sure in being mad, which none but the madman knows. But the important thing is the man is mad. These people, they sincerely believe in those things that are wrong. How will a man believe? He's been created a man, but he says he has feelings within him that he is a woman. And yet everything concerning the man is just manly. And then he goes on and puts on woman's dress and goes about and behaves and submits himself as if he's a woman to
even undertaking
man.
Surgeries to change their sexes. People go to that.
Well, of course, that does, I put it there, bisexual and transgender. And the transgender thing these days is becoming more and more common. You see, there's something when people seem to have so much little need. When I mean need, I mean physical needs.
Yes, sir.
When you have all things that physically you have, and I'm talking about so-called developed nations.
Nations.
And they tend to say, oh, science has proved this, science has proved that. But the point is, even if God himself said he has created you, in his own image. And that's why it's of all the animal kingdom, it is only man that can also create.
Exactly.
Now we're even creating robots, this artificial intelligence and so on. But you find that whatever man tries to create, he has to use what God has created. It is God who created the world and everything from nothing.
Exactly.
And it is he and only he who can do that.
Okay.
So they claim to be wise, but they are foolish. And that's why, and there's one thing, when God sees that you have vile passion, and then you are beyond redemption, he gives you that reprobate mind, and you became very base. You turn back to being an animal.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir. I trust that this study is quite enlightening and already blessing you. I pray you hearken to the call of God in our time by being chaste and morally pure. I pray that God indeed will help us as we hope to come back together to continue this discourse.
Yes.
Stay tuned. God bless you.
Thank you.
Simply living according to the word of God.
Pleasing God entails you staying with your wife in understanding according to the scripture, not in beating her.
Welcome back. Remember, This is Anglican Cable Network Nigeria. We've been here studying and learning at the feet of Jesus. Our topic says sexual perversion. And our resource persons, Reverend Canon Olusegun Majekudumi, the Vicar Anglican Church of the Epiphany here in Abuja Diocese, has been with us, sir. Welcome again.
Thank you.
And then Mrs. Adeola Bako, a parishioner and a Bible study teacher, the Anglican Church of Pentecost. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Let's look at question four. Why must sexual perversion be condemned? What are its dangers? Ma, Genesis chapter 19, 11 to 13, quickly.
And they struck the men who were at the doorway of the house with blindness, both small and great, so that they became weary trying to find the door. Then the men said to Lot, "Have you anyone else here? Son-in-law, your sons, your daughters, and whomever you have in the city, take them out of this place, for we will destroy this place, because the outcry against them has grown great before the face of the Lord, and the Lord has sent us to destroy it."
Leviticus 20:13, if a man practices homosexuality, having sex with another man as with a woman, both men have committed a detestable act, they must both be put to death, for they are guilty of capital offense. Why must we condemn this? Especially as we see it steadily, slowly perhaps, or steadily having an inroad into even the church. So why must we condemn it, and what are the dangers therein?
We have to condemn it because first and foremost, it's against God's law.
Mm-hmm.
God has said it. Those who are perverts, they must die. And the very act is an abomination.
Exactly.
And it's detestable before God. And we can see even from the story of Lot there, when the men were trying to come in. And even at the end of the day, what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah? The city was destroyed because of the sexual perversion. There was so much wrong with that city. So it is something that, you know, must be totally condemned.
Exactly.
Because it is against, you know, God's law.
Exactly. Yeah. And so will a life be even destroyed?
Yes.
If a life goes on in the way of perversion,
exactly,
that person will end up in ruin.
Praise the Lord. I just want to add that it's so much against the law of God and the will of God.
Exactly.
Because what God tells man is to go and replenish
the earth.
The earth. How do you replenish?
You
thank you very
that,
much, sir.
That's right.
Mm. Let's look at question five. We read Judges chapter 19, verse 22. I'll read very quickly. While they were enjoying themselves, a crowd of troublemakers from the town surrounded the house. They began beating at the door and shouting to the old man, "Bring out the man who is staying with you so we can have sex with him." The old man stepped outside to talk to them. "No, my brothers, don't do such an evil thing, for this man is a guest in my house, and such a thing would be shameful. Here, take my virgin daughter and this man's concubine. I will bring them out to you, and you can abuse them and do whatever you like, but don't do such a shameful thing to this man." But they wouldn't listen to him. So the Levi took hold of his concubine and pushed her out of the door. The men of the town abused her all night, taking turns raping her until morning. Finally, at dawn, they let her go. At daybreak, the woman returned to the house where her husband was staying. She collapsed at the door of the house and lay there until it was light. When her husband opened the door to leave, there lay his concubine with her hands on the threshold. He said, "Get up, let's go." But there was no answer. So he put her body on his donkey and took her home. When he got home, he took a knife and cut his concubine's body into 12 pieces. Then he sent one piece to each tribe throughout all the territory of Israel. Everyone who saw it said, "Such a horrible crime has not been committed in all the time since Israel left Egypt. Think about it. What are we going to do? Who is going to speak up?" How do you respond to verse 30? That's the question, looking at this text. Let me read verse 30 again. Everyone who saw it said, "Such a horrible crime has not been committed in all the time since Israel left Egypt. Think about it. What are we going to do? Who is going to speak up?" Reverend Canon, sir.
Thank you very much, because it says such a terrible crime had never been done in Israel. We must realize that the background to this story has to do also with tribe, with hatred, not being able to go into a particular tribe's house and
exactly,
so on. Well, finally they got accommodation. But then these men came and wanted to misbehave. to pervert. And eventually, this woman, this concubine, was put to them, and they raped the woman terribly. So much so, she finally came home and she died at the doorstep. And of course, the man was hoping he would come out, pick her up, and they will continue with their journey. But then when he found she was dead, the man was so taken in. What could I do? And then in bitterness, he took her, sliced her into 12 portions, 12 tribes of Israel, and then distributed the parts all over to each location, as it were. It shows how perverse the situation was in that place. Mm. And if the Bible is saying they had never seen it in this version, what we're seeing in Nigeria now, the herdsmen killing people all over, have we ever seen it in that version? Mm. How do you compare some people who will go to another person's home, pick the daughter, and force that daughter into marriage, and the man cannot ask questions? And that kind of thing is becoming more rampant than ever before. The way Nigeria is sinking into the abyss of unrighteousness, hatred, killing, murder, and it's like nothing is happening.
Only God.
Questions are not being asked enough. Answers are not forthcoming. Then we need to pray.
Yes.
And one thing I also want to mention is this perversion thing permeates down, and we should be looking at the younger generation. God will help us.
Amen.
Ma, and I want to add,
like your parting shot.
The Levites, the action he did, it was an act for call for justice.
Exactly.
From the offenders, you know, and it's a declaration of war.
Thank you very much, ma'am. It's important. It's important that we stand on the path of truth, especially in the light of what we are seeing in our world. Perversion everywhere. Sexually, you see a lot of young people, old people engaging in things we've never heard of. God, like you say, Daddy, we need to pray, and God will help us that our land be healed in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Conclusion. Sexual perversion is only an evidence of depravity and rejection by God, by people steeped in sin and who refuse to repent. It is expedient, therefore, to seek to deal with the matter from its root. Mere verbal attacks will not achieve much. Those engaged in it need desperate help. Food for thought. Those trapped by sexual perversion need deliverance. Our memory verse together. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. Let's read. Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites. Thank you. We trust that the Lord has blessed you. And I pray that beyond hearing the word of God, the grace will be sufficient for you to also do. And as we do this, God indeed will bless us and bless our homes, and perhaps heal our country in our time, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
We want to thank our resource persons, the Reverend Canon Olusegun Majekudumi. Thank you for honoring God once again.
Thank
and our mommy,
it's a
Mrs. Adeola Bako, thank you.
Thank you.
Our greetings. We invite you to be part of this again, same time, same station next week, as we continue, as we await His coming to learn at the feet of Jesus. You can give us feedback, and you can be part of what God is doing in our time, in our generation, and in our communion. Give us feedback how this program is reaching out and blessing you, as we are committed to taking the undiluted word of God throughout the nations. God bless you. I remain your host, Ejekam Chukwuebuka.
This is